photograph him. So Dr. Reddy already has briefed about the importance of nutrition. So but wherever I go, in any of the health conferences or nutrition conferences, everybody talks about nutrition. And they say that it has significant role and it's so important for every disease condition. But really, when it comes to the ground level, I really don't see much happening at ground level. So I was just looking at, is there any way where we can look at a sustainable nutrition, not only to mitigate the doses, we are looking at the doses, but in general, can we really look at any program, anything which can be sustainable, which can show us some results? So I'm trying to put out my thoughts, which are existing at present in the with the government, which most of the NGOs are also following, and also a few of my ideas where we can work out to make it much better. So nutrition status in India, of Indians, we can look at it. So before going in detail about how we can look at the fluorosis mitigation, I just want to brief you about what we eat, how we spend, and how we are nutritional, so that it is much easier for us to look at the sustainable nutrition. Next slide. So this is our food consumption. When you look at any age group, I actually have taken the age group of only children, but any age group, when you look at it, the intake of food item, whatever is recommended by NIM, we are not really consuming it. For example, if you are looking at a child of 1 to 3 years, he's supposed to take around 300 ml of milk, whereas we are giving him only 72 ml of milk. So it is less than around one third of whatever the important recommendations are there. None of them are really crossing more than 50%. Next slide. Can you just go back to that? And apart from that, this is the important one I really want you to notice. In pregnant ladies, no one is consuming any extra food, whatever they were consuming before. Even though there are recommendations that at the time of pregnancy, there is a requirement more of calories, proteins, vitamins, and minerals, and you have to increase the food quantity to double the amount that you need to eat for two, whatever it is. But in practice, nobody is consuming more amount of food during their pregnancy. And how we spend the food? Out of 1 rupee, 55 paisa we spend on the food. In this 55 paisa, 70% we are spending on cereals, sugars and spices. Less than 25% we are really spending on nutrient dense food items. That it can be fruits, it can be vegetables, or it can be milk and meat products. So whatever we are spending is, we are spending them to get more amount of energy. Next slide. So due to our consumption, dietary pattern, the adults suffer with chronic energy disorder and also many macronutrient deficiency. And especially in mothers, there is poor weight during pregnancy, which led to low birth weight and deficiency in macronutrient deficiency in children. And in endemic areas, there is fluorosis and laxism. And World Bank has predicted that by 2015, India is going to suffer with the maximum number of deaths are going to happen with cardiovascular diseases, and highest number of diabetics are going to be there in India. So all of them are directly related to what we eat and how much we are eating. So that has direct effect of all these conditions. Next slide. So this is a comparison of NFHS, that is National Family Health Survey, which is normally is conducted for every 7 years. So till now we have 3 NFHS surveys. In that you can see here a comparison of NFHS 2 and NFHS 3. You cannot really see any significant difference at all. What you can really notice is that there is an increase in anemia after providing and spending so many millions of rupees by providing IFA capsules to the pregnant ladies and to adolescent girls. Still, the anemia has not been, we are not able to control it. In fact, there is a rise in anemia. And also, when you look at the wasting of the children, it is also on the rise. So we are not able to tackle the malnutrition, we are not able to tackle the micronutrient deficiency, whereas there is increase in various other nutritional status. And from this on, we also got the first rank in many conditions, like the first rank, the highest number of malnourished children are in India, not in sub-Saharan countries. And the highest number of children with vitamin A deficiency and nutritional blindness are there in India. And highest number of anemic people are there in India. And highest number of diabetics are there in India. And highest, and one of the 10 countries in obesity, we are going to be one of them. And the highest 10 countries with the heart disease, India is going to be there. So all of them are, all these conditions are directly related to what we are eating. Our nutritional status predicts what we are going to be. So with all these diseases, now the fluorosis is also going to be one of the public health problems. And the endemic areas, because the soil content of the fluorine is increasing, and many states are also coming up, as Dr. Reddy has mentioned, that 20 states out of 35 states are suffering with fluoride toxicity. Next slide. So as I said, we already know that the fluorosis has two basic components when I really want to go in detail. One is the bone-seeking nutrients and minerals and other vitamins. The other thing is the malnutrition, which I mean to say is undernutrition. So one is that directly looking at the nutrient deficiencies of calcium or vitamin C, magnesium, which Dr. Reddy elaborately explained that how they are important because they are bone-seeking elements. And apart from that, the malnutrition itself. So when I say malnutrition, it is proper weight gain. It is also the sufficient amount of calories, proteins being there in the diet. The right amount of growth development happening at the right time. All these comes under malnutrition. So this undernutrition and fluoride toxicity link is nothing new. We know that as early as 1973 by Krishnamachari, and later supported by various studies. And also it has been mentioned that socioeconomic, low socioeconomic status and poor people are more affected with fluorine toxicity. Definitely because their consumption of the food is much lesser than well-to-do families. And also, malnourished individuals are more prone for skeletal fluorosis, not only for dental fluorosis. So next slide. Coming to the nutrition fluorosis, the bone-seeking nutrients, as we mentioned, calcium, magnesium is the or the basic two nutrients which we are going to concentrate and which we have to ensure that how to get these nutrients in our diet. When I talk about calcium, well, most of the plant sources have got the highest source of calcium. Normally, whenever I ask somebody, what is the richest source of calcium? Anybody can answer that?
Milk.
Yeah. That is the typical answer I get because the milk is the one which is properly absorbed and which is recommended by everybody. But milk has around 240 milligrams of calcium, whereas when you look at the thing, it has 2000 milligrams of calcium. Okay, so apart from that, there are various food substances which are for low cost, but it has got its own limitations. I'm going to discuss about it. So one is that about the calcium content itself, and the other one is the malnutrition part of it. Again, that part of it I'm going to discuss later. Apart from calcium and magnesium, next slide, there are various other nutrients, like some of them can potentiate the fluorosis, some of them can mitigate. So in the mitigation of fluorosis, we know calcium, magnesium are going to play a role, but whereas the silicon and molybdenum is going to potentiate the fluoride content. So we need to really look out for, whenever we are going for analysis, are they silicon and molybdenum? Are there higher proportions in the water? We need to really look for. And apart from that, vitamin C is one more component. How it is going to really helpful, we are not really sure. But vitamin C has to be there in appropriate amounts. That is the minimum. Recommended allowance itself is 40 milligrams. And can anybody know what is the highest source of vitamin C here?
Lemon juice.
Highest and the richest?
Amla.
So 100 grams of amla almost gives us 600 milligrams of vitamin C. So whenever we can able to store this and use it on a regular basis, it is not so difficult to get vitamin C in our diet. Next slide. So this is something which I really want to discuss with you. This when I visited Jabuwa last year, I visited Yashodkin, Kunj, and the other one is Mayadi.
Mm.
Okay. So when I went there, when I looked at people, and Sundar and Induda on the way discussed that this area was totally full of forest, and it's a very short span of time it has been reforested. And then I went and I realized that environmental changes definitely influences and can lead to malnutrition. The reason is, whenever there is environmental changes, the loss of no resources, non-availability of the food what they were taking, were totally missing. So that led to poverty. From the poverty, they lead to malnutrition, which can really aggravate the skeletal process. Next slide. So this is the Bill tribe. When I went and interacted with them, the first generation of people, just to impress one more time, are really, you know, strong, warrior-like. You know, they have the Rajput type of body structure. And but when I looked at the generation, next generation, their children, they are crippled, deformed, stunted. So what really happened here is, as I said, mentioned earlier, the no resources are not there. These tribe is basically hunter-gatherers. These hunter-gatherers has been shifted to eating cereals. So the literature, the studies also proves that whenever a hunter-gatherer who was taking the animal food shifts from the animal food to the plant-based food, there are going to be deficiency of anemia, the state, there is a stuntedness, there is going to be osteomalacia, all those things. So which I really looked at it, you know, you can see that it is a live example how the environment can change the whole generations to come. I don't know how long will it take for the Bill tribe to get back their identity, to see their own children of their, you know, whatever the tribe is for, strong and barrier life type of growth and development. Next slide. So because of this loss of habitation, they are forced into agriculture, but really they don't know what is edible and what is not edible. Next slide. So the children have become very stunted, loss of food and culture, traditional food habits, malnourishment, and severe fluoride toxicity. So this is what our observation is like. So Bill tribe, change in environment, cultural change, for the hunters, wheat was their staple food. Because of the forced agriculture, they started eating cereals. They grow soybean, but they don't know they can eat soybean. So just sell it and just get some amount of corn and then eat only makiki roti. And that led to less intake of food and malnourishment. Thereby, there is a severity of skeletal fluorosis. Next slide. So food security is something we talk whenever we say that there is a malnourishment, there is a deficiencies. The immediate answer anybody can get or anybody can answer is that there is no food available. Is it really true was my question. So what we mean by food security is availability, accessibility of food, everyone all the time in the community. You can see here the production and the availability, per capita availability of cereals and pulses. There is an increased production, but whereas per capita availability has really gone down. Especially when you look at pulses, in 1950 itself, per capita availability of the pulses was around 60 grams, but whereas in 92, the per capita availability has gone down to 36.3. And most of the time in newspapers we say that, you know, all our granaries are full, they're, you know, they are getting really rotten up and other things. But still, when you really look at the nutritional status of the children, every two Indian children unable to access enough food for their physical development, for their brain development, into its full potential. So what is the reason for food insecurity? One is that there is a dependency on limited food items. You just look at across India, rice or the beef are the two staple food. And when I am a small child or in my childhood, I used to consume jawar ki roti on a regular basis. Now you go to the same way, jawar ki roti is not available. They eat three times only rice because the periods, the public distribution system gives rice, which is much cheaper than the jowar. So our dependency has gone up and we almost produce 3 times more than the requirement of rice, but we import many other food substances at higher rate. And at the same time, you can see here, we depend only on 17 plant species, which can provide us 90% of the nourishment. And out of 1,95,000 species which are available, which are edible, which can provide us energy, nutrients and many more medicinal property, but we are using only 0.1% of them. That is, we are using only 300 species as our food sources. Many of the food items which were part of our diet now considered as a weed. So this is one example, is Cassiotola. Especially in this part, it is available in the monsoon. Most of them still traditionally they use a smaller quantity of it. And there are various studies have been done on this Cassiotola, which is rich in calcium. Even UNICEF recommended that it can be used as a natural supplement. So, but we don't want to use all these sources. We just say that either we need to have only milk or only fortified food or only a tablet. But because we are missing out many other nutrient providing plant species in our diet. That's why there is a lot of food insecurity. And as I mentioned earlier also, present food and nutrition programs, there are 3 major food programs. One is ICDS, as you all be aware of, because this ICDS, Anganwadi workers, who provides food for pregnant lady, for children. For pregnant lady, they call it as a double ration. And most of the time, sometime they give rice and dal. Sometime from a factory, like in Andhra Pradesh, there is AP Food Industries are there, where they really mix up the components of soybean and other things and fortify it, and then they are distributed. First, when they distributed these ICDS, even though it is nutritionally quite high, rich in many nutrients, rich in protein content, nobody has consumed it. Most of the time it has been fed to animals, because it is not something which they are used to. There was no awareness program about it, so they never consumed it. So the nutrition status, as you can see, there is no change at all. And second thing is midday meal program. In the midday meal program, very recently, we added egg twice a week. Otherwise, it is completely a cereal pulse base. Cereal pulse base combination provides energy, provides some amount of protein, but the quality of the protein, but to get the maximum amount of nutrients, especially at the time of growth, is not really sufficient enough. We could have included egg or any type of animal-based food products in ICDS or in the midday meal program, but very recently we started using it, because whenever there is only cereal and pulses, because if you are a vegetarian, along with the cereals and pulses, you need to consume more amount of vegetables, you need to consume more amount of foods to get the vitamins and minerals, which is not really happening with poor or with the government programs. So we really need to look at the alternative source of nutritional intervention program. Or is there anything really we can work on where a sufficient amount of vitamins, minerals can be provided along with calories and protein, which we need to consider about. See, this is just I want to show that why the plant source is not really sufficient enough to provide the nutrients which are required for the growth and development, and especially to mitigate the malnutrition. When you look at the iron, if you are providing in the form of the plant source, which is present as a non-heme iron, which is not really properly absorbable. So the recommendation is that at least a small amount of animal food should be there along with the meal, so that the iron can be absorbed properly. Similarly, in the case of vitamin A, vitamin A is present only in the animals, but whereas in the plant, it is present in the form of keratin, which need to be converted. So if at all you want to take it in the form of keratin, you need to really eat in a good quantity. So at least you need to include large quantity of fruits and vegetables, otherwise a small amount of animal source will be good enough. Coming to calcium, as I said, that till has 2000 milligrams of calcium. But you may ask that how come government never looked at it? How come many of the nutritionists not recommend that? Because of the presence of phytate and oxalates, which hinders the absorption of calcium. That's why we really don't consider, or we don't really recommend, if you're getting only 1 rupee, and out of that 1 rupee, if whatever is absorbed properly, if I can give it to you, that is going to be more beneficial. So it's easy for me to go for milk. But there are various other ways where you can reduce the phytate quantity and other things, thereby you need to require using animal sources also one of the alternatives. And coming to B12, which is one of the important nutrients, this also is not present in the plant source at all. So unless you drink milk for a vegetarian, you don't get B12. So pure vegans, normally what we call, they are not going to get B12. So at least a small amount of milk has to be there in one's diet. So when we are looking at a malnourished children, where the supplementation is mid-meal program is only cereal and pulses, there is no animal source. And most of the time for these children, mid-meal program is going to be the only meal of the day. Most of them, they don't even eat breakfast after going back home. We really don't know how much they can afford to eat. So when we are giving only one meal, either in the form of ICDS as MNMOLI source or from mid-meal program, can we really give this one single meal which is really nutrient dense, instead of making it just in the form of calculating the calories, calculating the protein is not sufficient enough. Whether the proteins and calories is really useful for the child to grow and develop properly to its full potential is something we really need to think about it and then work on these programs. This is something I really noticed again in Jabuwa. When I tried to interact with the women, none of them came forward to talk. I just asked them to come and sit with us. None of them moved from their chair. And also I was thinking that what type of power or decision-making authority these people really have in their life. And when we are saying about women empowerment, in India, the woman is either considered as a devi and you do puja, otherwise she's a dasi, get the work done. But never a human being who requires a normal care and food is something I found is totally missing, not only in Jabuwa, but the park. Whenever I went into the field, when I observed, I just felt that women empowerment, we really need to look at in a different way, whether it is really possible, because many agencies are working to improve the women's status. But are we really doing an appropriate way, something which I was looking at? Next slide. And this gender inequality has been from 2000 BC, from Manu, who said that by any girl or by any woman, or even by aged one, nothing must be done independently, even in her own house. So the legacy we are just carrying. The woman is not empowered. Woman has very low status in our community or in our society. And you can look at here, 80% of the women participated what to cook. But only 40% can able to say that what she can do what with her earnings. So this limits the power, how to use the money for her own good health or for the health of the child and nutrition part of it. Because of this, next slide, you can see that low birth rate is quite high. You can see next to Nepal, ours is one more, one of the first and second ranks we get in low birth rate. Even though there is improvement in maternal mortality, even though there is improvement in infant mortality, but still there is no improvement in low birth rate. This is the area where we really need to look at. When we are talking about sustainable nutrition, when we are talking about mitigation of fluorosis, it is not somewhere once there is a deformity, once you notice a change in the dental coloration, then you try to intervene something and try to do it. Because, next time, this is the area, the first 1,000 days of life is something which we really need to concentrate. So the pregnancy plus first 2 years after the birth is very, very important. And looking at the food security and nutrition interventions and women empowerment, again, I just can put my own thoughts that how it can be possible. Why I say that first 1,000 days is so important? Because during pregnancy, if the chlorine content is high, in the baby itself, the enzyme and hormonal system is going to be affected, which is going to affect the mineralization. So the fluorosis is starting when the baby is there in mother's womb, at the fetus level. And one of the important and the simplest thing what we can do is whether the pregnant lady is gaining sufficient amount of weight or not. That one single parameter, if we can able to look at and able to manage it, then it is possible to limit the low birth weight. When we are not able to get a low birth weight child, there is an adequate amount of nutrition can be taken care of. The other feeding practices, we all know that these interventions are there in place from years, from decades. The colostrum feeding, exclusive feeding for 6 months, and need for the additional food of ICDS and other things. But one important aspect which I noticed is the quantity and quality of the food. The quality, at least there is some amount of education going on, but when you look at the quantity, if I go for a midday meal program, do I really know that how much I am supposed to eat? Whether I am getting my right portion of it or not? Is there any standard cup, standard katori or standard glass where this much of rice and this much of dal has to go? If I am cooking that, I just take away a kg of dal and put more water into that. Or if I am not really serving, if I want to, after cooking, if I want to take away the food, I just serve a half a spoon less of it. Next slide. So the NIN has given a standard cups and glasses and spoons. But these glasses and cups are not available anywhere. Literally, I have to work for 1 week. Where I took a tape, they are given a measurement that the circumference of the glass at the top should be 6 centimeters, at the below it should be 3 centimeters, the length should be this much. But to measure those things, literally I went around all the steel shops measuring it, and later something similar, quite nearer to that, I was able to find. But very simple way, at least the education about using hand measures. This is the work we have done it. Anybody fist, if you take rice, a woman's fist carries around 30 grams of rice and male it is 35. So can we just say that if a child is around 6 months old, you know, after 6 months, you need to feed the child a fistful of rice. You know, now mother just put some amount of rice and gives it to him. He may eat it, he may throw it, or mother even don't know. The child refuses, she just leaves it and goes. But can we say that 3 times you can eat, give the child fistful of it? Or can we able to say a pregnant lady, 3 times you eat this much of rice or this much of dal, which 2 handfuls of it carries around 130 to 140 grams of rice, raw rice. So at least these type of simple measures are not there. No education has been done. And we always say that there is no food available. But whatever, even if it is a makki ki or roti, or even if it is rice which is available at the household level, are we recommending them what is the minimum quantity they need to go for? There are no education about it. There are no standards about it. Next slide. So food security, using locally grown food items, ICDS, midday meal programs, ICDS programs, and preservation of seasonal and less known food items, as we said, cassia tura can be used. And most importantly, I feel that agriculture, food and nutrition are interconnected. All these departments really need to work together, not as a separate entity. Right? This is the male sensitization. I was again looking at women empowerment. Most of the time, the moment the girl is pregnant, you know, most of the education goes to the girl that you need to eat more, you need to do that, you need to do this, take rest for 2 hours. But who will do the work? Who will really feed her? You need to go for the visits. Okay? So there is more responsibility on the girl without any power. But there is not even a single program on maternal health and care. When I looked at the government programs of maternal health and care, there is only 2 points they mentioned about the male members. It is about use of condoms and space. That's the only thing which they mentioned about the male member role in the whole of maternal and child care. But whereas in the case of women, there is lot of education and awareness happening what is really important to do at the time of pregnancy, but without any power. So can we involve the father? Can we involve the spouse? Where we can say that IFA tablets are so important, so make sure that your wife is eating. Make sure that she's going to take rest so that you can take we can take on the work. And make sure that the weight gain of the child is proper. So these are the few things which need to be considered. And this is very interesting point. Again, Jabuwa, they mentioned that Dayas, that is a male member, is the one who conducts the delivery in Bill tribe. So this type of participation is already there traditionally in some tribes, in some communities. So can we use this source? Can we educate the Dayas about the maternal care and what to feed and how to feed and how to take care of the nutritional point of it?
Yeah.
So in summary, as I mentioned again before, the moment we say that malnutrition, the only answer everybody gets it, give more food. Now there is Food Security Act is going to come up, which they are talking about to provide more food without any responsibility. But that is not the answer. There are many other interventions which are needed to strengthen the program so that we can see some difference in the malnutrition status. Next slide. So the sustainable nutrition of the diet includes environment, food and nutrients, culture, equity, and well-being and health also. Thank you.